were sent to work outside, to some outside factories or to clean the streets, and that the people who owned businesses before the war were able to create what they called workshops, so that everybody in the ghetto had to be employed. And these were so many workshops. There were people, there were tailor workshops, a shoemaker and dressmaker and brush makers. And I worked in a printing shop because my parents knew the people in charge and they felt I would be safe there. And again, in the beginning, we all thought it's not going to last long. We thought we're going to be working and the war will fall outside our walls and the war will end and we'll all go back to the way it was before. That's how it was before. But of course, that never happened. Because as soon as people really settled, the workshops were working, the soldiers starting to patrol the streets, they would come into apartments, into the workshops. The workshops always ran on double shifts. So you never knew when you left the home whether you would come back. And you really never knew when you were home when somebody is going to come and try and take you away. I remember that one horrible day my mom told me that my grandparents will not get a permit anymore and that I should hide with them. And we lived in this big, big building that had a huge courtyard. And there was a mass of dirt, a huge hill of dirt and pine cones and pine needles. And my mother sort of helped us make like a tunnel. And very early in the morning, we crawled into that little tunnel and she covered us and she had to go to work. And I remember laying on my stomach and the whole ground was shaking. The trucks carrying the soldiers came into the ghetto and the soldiers jumped from the trucks and they were running through the streets and the sound of the boots and the sound of them screaming. I remember how scared I was, how shaky I was. And then we heard them running through the apartments and we heard shots where people were hiding. And they were breaking windows and throwing dishes and furniture out of the window. It was a nightmare. But finally, it seemed like an eternity, they started to leave. And as they were leaving, I could feel that they were surrounding the hill in where we were hiding and they were putting their rifles through, but they didn't find us. And then it was quiet. And after a while, my mom came in. It was dusk already. Nobody was around anymore, and she helped us get out. And we were standing in the courtyard, trying to clean up. You know, I remember trying to take some of the dust and dirt out of my hair. And all of a sudden, we came face to face with the last patrol of the day. There were two young German soldiers, and they were very quiet. They were very polite. But of course, they took my grandparents away, and we cried. But in a way, we were lucky that they didn't shoot them right in front of us, and they didn't shoot me and my mom. And of course, I never saw my grandparents away. They went to Auschwitz. And we didn't know that. How could you? How could you imagine? Could not imagine. A few weeks later, my father was arrested in the midnight. It was December 31st, 1942. My father was arrested. He was charged with being involved with resistance. That was not true. Somebody, for some reason, decided that my father was not supposed to be around. And I remember I went downstairs from the building because the night shift was coming back at midnight that day. And I wanted to tell my uncle, who lived around the corner, but of course I was not allowed to go out on the street, and to tell his parents, my grandparents, and other brothers to see if anybody could save my father. My father was kept in the ghetto jail for a whole week while everybody was trying to get him out, but it didn't work. My father was, of course, a wonderful man besides being handsome and a good, good person trying to help everybody. Had a lot of contacts, he did a lot of good. And taking care of children who were sick, my father was able to arrange, I remember, for one family to take their baby to the hospital outside of the ghetto. Nothing helped. And they took my father away and never saw him again. And it was at that time, actually, that we started to hear about Oskar Schindler. And I am everybody here in this room must have seen that movie. In fact, I have to tell you that the movie is so accurate. Everything in that movie is what really happened. Everything in that movie happened to me. The first time I saw the movie, I felt like I left my seat and went in and lived through it all over again. Because Oskar Schindler, you know, he was a young, very handsome man, and he joined the Nazi party very early. He wanted to make a lot of money. He was very ambitious. He worked for his father selling farm equipment and really wasn't making much money. So he not only joined the Nazi party, but became very friendly with a lot of important generals and people in the government. And so he traveled a lot, he knew Krakow. So when the German came to Krakow, he followed them and he was looking for a business that would make him rich. He wanted to have a beautiful apartment. He wanted to own horses and cars and dress beautiful, which he did. So he entertained his so-called friends. He bribed them. He bought them gifts that you could only buy on the German on the black market, and the things that the German couldn't get, buying Poland themselves. So they liked him. I mean, he had parties where he drank with them. He never got drunk. He gambled with them, and he always lost. Whatever they wanted. He drank, and he sank, and in the same time, he took over a factory that belonged, of course, to a Jewish family, and was making pots and pans before the war. And when Oskar took over the factory, he had no idea how to run the business, so he depended on the people who did run it. Oskar Schindler, even though he wore a diamond swastika on his lapels, he did not have the heart of a Nazi. The people he did work for him became his friends. And those were the people that made him rich. And that's when Oskar Schindler looked at us and he said, no, I will not let anything bad happen to you as long as I can help it, and I will. It came to a point where people started to say, stop talking about Oskar Schindler because it reaches the ears of the Nazis, they were killing him. And all his contact would be for nothing. And so the day came when the ghetto was being confiscated. And totally empty. There is a scene in the movie where Amos Goetz, the commander of the camp and the one person that was going to liquidate the ghetto, came into the ghetto in a big car. Now, Amos Goetz was born in Austria, in Vienna. His parents owned and ran a very respected publishing business. And we thought, well, he's from Vienna, Austria, aristocratic family, he will be good. Amos Goetz was one of the worst sadistic murderers that ever lived. He loved to kill. He loved to kill young children and old people and anybody who wasn't moving fast enough or was too slow. Amos Goetz had a villa in the entrance of Plaszów, the concentration camp. And he would stand on his veranda every morning when people were going to work. And he would stand there and he would kill people. He would go hunting, but he was hunting for people. And one of his first victims of Amos Goetz was my uncle Roman, my father's younger brother, who was in charge of a group that was painting a barrel. He just shot him for no reason at all. The day that we had to leave the ghetto, we were only allowed to take a little small suitcase. And my mother and I were taking care of my cousin Jenny. She was 5 years old. Her parents, her mother was my mother's sister. And I don't know how. And at that time I never asked. One day they went to Tarnów, and from Tarnów the family was sent to Belgrade. She had an older sister, my age, and somehow my father was able, and my father was still around at that time, he was able to save the little girl. She was 5 years old, she was blonde, blue-eyed. I always tell my students in school, Hitler wanted to have an Aryan race. He wanted everybody blonde, blue-eyed, young and strong and beautiful. And if you stop to think about what Hitler looked like, and how all his so-called cabinet, what did they look like? They certainly, if anybody looked Jewish, that was Hitler. And that was Rosenberg and all the our children were all different color. They were blonde and red hair and black and brown. They had blue eyes and hazel eyes. They were beautiful. I never saw a child that was not beautiful. But in the eyes of the Germans and other anti-Semites, we were inhuman and we were worse than the roaches and cockroaches and mice, and we were not supposed to live. We were not allowed, we were living together, we were not allowed to take anybody under 12 with us, and anybody over 55 had to stay behind. I tried to take Jenny with me, and she walked next to me, she was holding onto my waist, and I wore a long coat. And as I was going to join the group from the paper printing shop, one of the soldiers stopped me and told me that I couldn't take her, that I had to put her back in the orphan's home. And you know, I was happy, because in the orphan's home was a regular building. There should have water and electricity and warmth, I hope, because the orphanage in Poland was always run by the nuns. So I thought, and I'm already the Erste, that the nuns would come and take over the orphan's home and take care of the children. There were so many children in the orphanage because the soldiers were bringing the children from the surrounding communities after, you know, already killing the parents. And I walked away thinking she would be safe. And I joined a group from the printing shop, and I realized that one couple and another couple, in their backpack, they were carrying their little babies. They were drugged. The children were drugged, so they wouldn't move, so they wouldn't make any noise. And those were the people who had friends, those we called the righteous Gentiles. Those people who risked their lives to save a Jewish child. And they were at risk, not just from the Nazis. They were at risk of their neighbor, because if a neighbor would suspect that they are hiding a Jewish child, they would report them to the authorities. And there were people who would be killed. The whole family would be killed for that. I had a cousin, actually, who survived by being given up by her parents, to given to Polish family. Her parents, of course, did not survive. And the Polish family, the father was taken away because somebody said that they had a Jewish child. And the mother was telling them that this was their grandchild, that the daughter had a baby out of wedlock. How could you imagine, how could you accept the fact that our beautiful children would be killed because we were Jewish? I remember walking into that camp. The camp was built on three Jewish cemeteries. And you can imagine what it was like to work there when they were building, when the ground was leveled. And they took the tombstone and they broke it up. And women were supposed to build the road, and the men were building the barracks, and people were being killed while they were working, not realizing that Amangel was walking behind us. And one time I was sitting on the road with my mother and a friend who stayed with us because her parents were taken away, and we were trying to put the little stones together. How can you make a road from stones when you have nothing but your hand? And all of a sudden, my friend fell over. And I said to her, you can't lay down now, you have to sit up, Amangel is coming. And Amangel always walked with two huge dogs. I've never seen such big dogs after the war, but I am afraid of big dogs. And I put my hand behind her, and I wanted to help her to stand up, sit up. And my hand was covered in blood. He was behind me, and he shot her. And I didn't hear, and I didn't know until I touched her and realized, and then I couldn't move because he was still around and if I moved, he would kill me too. Every morning and every night, we were stood for a roll call. And every morning and every night, we would be exposed to public hanging, public beating, and all kinds of horrible things. And we would be left standing on this huge upper parts, this huge, like a lawn, like a green lawn in summer. But you know,